Hallelujah. And I wanted to share that with you. Because before you can stir anything up, you have to understand that God loves you. If you don't receive His love, then you can't stir up a gift that He's placed inside of you. Amen. And I love the name of the ministry, Breaking the Chains, because you can't stir if you're bound.
Amen.
Amen. Pastor Joy, I go to Restoration Station Christian Fellowship in Edgewater Park, New Jersey. And my pastor, Pastor Joy, wrote a book called Roadmap to Destiny, 21-day devotional to reaching your destiny. And as she began to watch the people going through this journey, she realized that many of them had some stuff they were holding on to. They were bound by some things that they experienced in their past. And so they weren't able to travel that journey because they were stuck.
Yeah.
So she had to go back and write another book called Get Up. Amen. Get Up, 5 ways to getting up when life has knocked you down.
Amen.
So it is for us today. We can't stir up any kind of gifts if we're still holding on to things that happened to us in our past. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so some of us in here are tired. Some of us in here are ready to throw in the towel, if we can be honest. Because some of us have been trying to stir a swimming pool with a teaspoon.
That's good.
Hallelujah.
That's good.
And so I'm gonna be real practical this morning. I understand very clearly that you cannot move freely if you're still in a box.
That's good.
And so today, I want you to look at somebody in the eye and say, you cannot stir up the gift
from the inside of your box.
Hallelujah. And I believe that we're going to go from level to level today. I believe that I've come to just lay out some groundwork. And I don't mind being at the ground level, because I get to celebrate as you guys go up, as we go up. I get to celebrate with you as the chains fall. So I love being at the ground. I love when I get to invite somebody that's unchurched to the church, because I get to watch their transformation. I get to participate with them. I get to be a part of that cloud of witnesses that's just cheering them on. Amen. And so we're going to talk about getting out of our box. And I believe that in order, right? And so you're not going to stir something that's empty, right? It needs to be filled. It needs to be stirred so then it can be poured.
That's good.
So we're going to fill with some practicality.
That's good.
Brother Iso, he's going to stir us up.
Amen.
And then Reverend Jackson's going to help us to pour out. Amen. I believe that by the time we get to the end of this day, we're going to be ready to activate these gifts that we have on the inside of us. So sometimes in life, when things happen to us, we like to wear our circumstances sometimes because it's comfortable. You know, we live in a world where there's so much going on that if I'm not going through at the moment, I feel out of place because everybody's going through. So, you know, we try to find something to put on. How you doing today, girl? Tired. Now, you don't have 12 hours of sleep, but because that's the norm, because that's the average answer, you feel weird when you say, I'm blessed. I'm good. God is good. The sun is shining. I have breath in my body. My family is safe. I'm good. And then they look at you like, what's wrong with you? You know what I'm saying? So we have a culture that has conditioned us to complain when nothing's even wrong. And so paralyzed by fear and uncertainty, we create nice little safe boxes. We decorate them a little bit, put a little earring on it, and you know, put some J's on it, and we have a nice little box that we like to walk around in. So today we're gonna destroy the box. Amen? We're gonna destroy the box. I mean destroy it. I don't mean, you know, fold it up. You know how you save box, you fold them up, put them in a closet for later, and then at the opportune time, you're like, bam! Got my box back on. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, we like to put it back on later when we come to familiar situations. Yeah, we pull that box right out. Sometimes we're in boxes of hopelessness. And so, you know, you've been victorious for a little while and then something hits you, you put that box right back on. It's never gonna get better. Now, God did it before, but you put on that hopeless box and now you're talking about, I don't know how I'm gonna make it, when he just brought you out, like yesterday, right? We're that fickle. We're that, you know, that wayward. And so Before we can even pull out of the driveway with this, we have to acknowledge some things. Mm-hmm. First of all, you have to acknowledge that you're in a box.
Amen.
Amen. This is only going to be effective for people that are honest today. You have to acknowledge that you're in a box in the first place. And because a lot of times, like I said, if you're in that box of hopelessness, if you're in that box of depression, we put the lid of denial on top.
Right.
So we're walking around like, what box? What you mean? Now everybody see a big old, you know, cardboard fixture with tape and holes and rips. But you're like, what box? I'm good. You know what I'm saying? So we have to acknowledge that we're in a box. The second thing is you have to acknowledge that God, the creator of the universe, loves you so much that he didn't allow you to stay where you were. That you're here. You have to acknowledge and believe that he wants to use you. And not just, like I said yesterday, not for the sake of just stirring you up so you can walk around and just stir it. You know what I'm saying? But he's going to stir you up so that the people that come into contact with you experience a change in their lives. And so we have to acknowledge that. And we have to acknowledge that he loves us and desires to use us mightily. And then finally, we have to acknowledge that there's work to be done. Because it's one thing to say, yeah, I'm a mess. And then we stop there.
Right.
But no, I'm a mess and I desire to not be a mess. And I understand that that's going to take work. Amen. We're going to do some work today. God is going to do some work today. And I need you to understand that, yes, God is going to do the perfecting. He's going to do the refining. But we have a part in this too.
Amen.
The woman with the issue of blood understood that in order for her to reach the hem of his garment, she had to leave her house.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? In order for her to get her healing, she had to do her part.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Noah, he had to build that ark.
Yeah.
You know, for God to keep his promise to him, he had to do what the Lord said. So you understand, you know that there's work to do.
Yeah.
So you have to accept that there's work to do, and then you have to accept that there's work to do and get to work. Amen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. So we are going to turn to Exodus chapter 3. We're going to start in 3, then we're going to jump over to 4. And as you're turning, here we have Moses, right? And Moses had just had an encounter. He's still encountering the burning bush at this point. But this is Moses who God placed the gift of leadership on the inside of him. And so we get to take a peek inside of his life at the very moment that God wanted to stir that thing up so that he was ready to pour out. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I'm going to start at chapter 3, verse 10. I'm going to read 2 verses there, then we're going to hop over to chapter 4. You got it? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Chapter 3, verse 10 says, "So now, go. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" And God said, "I will be with you."
Amen.
That's a word for somebody in here. He will be with you. And this will be the sign that to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Now we're going to skip over to chapter 4, verse 1. Moses answered, "What if they don't believe me or listen to me and say, 'The Lord did not appear to you?'" Now, Moses, you have to imagine, put yourself in Moses' shoes. This whole time, he's been on the backside of a mountain, tending sheep, taking care of a family. He thought his life was over. He thought God was through with him, right? And so he's like, "What do you mean I'm going to go set the people free?" And so after that, God gave him some examples. Well, if they say, "I don't believe you," then do this. If they don't believe that, then do this. And if they don't believe that, then go ahead and do this. He gave him some instruction. So then we're going to jump down to verse 10 and read through to 17.
Okay.
So after his instruction, Moses said to the Lord, "Pardon your servant, Lord. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." He said, "God, I got a stutter and I don't know no big words."
Right.
That's what he said. And then God, I love God because he's like, he has an answer for everything, y'all. He has an answer, and his answer is enough. Amen. So the Lord said to him, "Who gave human beings their mouths? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go. I will help you speak and will teach you what to say." But Moses said, "Pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else." Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, And yet he said, what about your brother, Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He's already on his way to meet you, and he will be glad to see you. Now this, if I don't know, I don't know anywhere else in the word, but this is an example of God's grace.
Amen.
Because in one verse it said God was angry,
yeah.
And then in the next verse it said, but God heard his petition.
Yeah.
Amen. He was concerned about the things that Moses was concerned about. So that's the gracious God that we serve. Amen. 15, you shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hands and you can perform the signs with it. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you for your presence that's in this place. I thank you, Father God, for the word that you've prepared for all of us. Father, I pray right now that you would use me for your glory, and I pray that this word, this message, this word, God, would fall on ears that are ready to receive it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we have Moses, and today in the room there are Moseses, Mosai. There are many of him in this room. Amen. And like I said, God presented him with a great task.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say, go to the well and fill some buckets of water. Because that would have been easy. He didn't say, go and pray over your family. Because even that would have been easy. No, he said, go to Pharaoh and tell him to let my people go.
Yes.
Now, he was like, wait, you want me to tell Pharaoh that a bush told me, like I was intending the sheep, and then the bush told me to come tell you to let the people go. He knew that wasn't going to go over well, right? And so put yourself in his place. There's some things that God has asked you to do. There are some things that he's commissioned you to do, some things that he's given you a mandate to do. And if we can be honest, on the first receiving of that thing, we were like, I don't know about that, Jesus. You want me to do what? Amen. And so getting back to the stirring of the gifts. If I told you to stir something, demonstrate how to stir something, what would you do? All right, we got three people. That's okay, okay. She looked like Double Dutch over there. Amen. Amen. But seriously, if I told you to stir, I want all of you, show me how you stir. Show me. All right, so we got some people with some big spoons. We got some, I see somebody with a little teaspoon whipping it like that. So I know somebody in here has a whisk. They in here, you know what I'm saying? The beautiful thing in that demonstration is that everybody stirs differently.
Yes.
Amen? I love that. Everybody stirs differently. But we all know how to stir. Right? And so I need a volunteer who's not claustrophobic. Amen. I need a volunteer. Come on, don't make me grab somebody. I need one person. Just one person. All you gotta do is stand here. All you gotta do is stand. Amen. Amen. I have a lovely wardrobe for you. So you're gonna keep your hands to your side. Just gonna put you. I'ma put you. But you're gonna keep your hands inside. Because, so this is just a demonstration, right? It's a demonstration. But in real life, the boxes that we're in are like over our whole bodies. And probably a lot tighter than this one, right? And so imagine that this is you in your box. Now, I want you to show me your stir again. Oh, and okay, so she can't effectively stir from the inside of her box. While she has the ability, she has the operative skills, the motor skills to do it, but she can't stir from inside of her box. And so the same way it is with you. You have gifts on the inside of you. And while the Bible says that your gifts make room for you, you have to make room for your gifts first.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You need to make room for your gifts first. And so from the inside of a box, she can't operate in her gifts from in there. Right? And so you make room for your gifts by way of exposure. You share your gifts with the world. And then your gifts making room for you is just your gifts returning the favor.
Amen.
But your gifts ain't gonna make room for you if you don't make room for your gifts first. Amen? And the Bible says that when your gifts make room for you, they're going to bring you before great men. Well, great men don't know that they have need of you if they don't know who you are. Great men don't know that they have need of you if they don't know what you can do. Amen? So we have to allow our gifts to make, we make room for our gifts, and then our gifts will make room for us. Amen?
Amen.
Awesome. So our box is made up of different things. Mm-hmm. For everybody, is, as I say, different strokes for different folks.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's box is made up of different things.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a couple of things mm-hmm. that might help you identify what kind of box you're in.
That's good.
All right, so God, he works with me in foolish things, right? And he gives me acronyms. I love acronyms. So if you're taking notes, this is it's a 1, 2, 3 kind of thing. All right, so the first thing that your box might be made out of is backwards thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Backwards thinking. Backwards thinking. Our friend Moses said, well, what if they don't believe me? What if they reject me? What if I don't get that financial aid? What if I don't get that job? What if I never get married? What if I never attract the investors that I need? When you live in a box, you have a tendency to expect the worst first.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's backwards. You know, when you're getting ready to get outside for work, you're like, oh Lord, traffic is going to be horrible. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't see the highway from your house. You know what I'm saying? Oh, it's going to be terrible. It's just going to be standstill, bumper to bumper. You are confessing death over your commute to work without even knowing it. You place an order at a restaurant, they're going to get my order wrong. I'm going to find hair in my food. Like, backwards thinking. You know, you want to go to school. I'm not going to get in. I have a girlfriend who's connected to me, and she wants to go back to school. I'm like, go on, get your degree. Go ahead, girl, I'm all for it. Yeah, but I gotta take a placement test. I'm probably not gonna pass, so why even bother? I said, now you just claimed victory and defeat all in one breath. And this is somebody that, you know, when I'm down in my dumps, and when she's the one pulling me out, like, oh no, you got girls to deliver and people to save. And now she's talking about, I can't pass no placement test. I said, if you don't get up there and start clicking buttons, the Holy Spirit is gonna give you the answers. All you have to do is put your hand to the plow. That's the work that you have to do. You have to do your part, right? And so Moses, he said, listen, I'm about to get up here and tell these people a bunch of stuff, and they're not going to believe me. But he was focused on the recipient's response instead of focusing on the sender's message. Right? So you have to remember who sent you. You have to remember who commissioned you. You have to remember who empowered you, who gave you that gift. So when the people say, well, I don't like your music, so? God sent me. Because now they're going to go home like, I didn't like that song. And they're going to be in the headline. Why do I? Where did that lyric come from? It's going to be in their head, in their spirit. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So you have to remember who sent you. Amen?
Amen.
And then number two. Oh, I'm going to have you turn to one of your sides. The O. Oppressive outlooks.
Mm-hmm.
Oppressive outlooks. Oppressive means overwhelming or depressive to the spirit or senses. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He had a negative view of himself.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't view yourself as positive, if you don't view yourself as powerful, if you don't view yourself as anointed, if you don't see yourself as God sees you, you ain't starting up nothing but a bunch of misery and depression and something that people don't want to be around. Amen. When you don't view yourself, because how many of you have ever been around that person and they just have that stinky outlook on their lives? You're like, oh gosh, I gotta be with Jaquisha. I want to pick a name if somebody was in here. Anybody named Jaquisha in here? No? Okay. So yeah, you might be like, okay, here comes Jaquisha, and you know she just comes in and she just dampens the whole mood. Even with the way she says hello.
Hey.
You know what I'm saying? That's an oppressive outlook. And we will walk around with these things and not even know it. You know, there was one point in my life where my finances were just nothing. They were nothing, right? And so I developed an oppressive outlook around my financial situation. And so I would walk around like, oh, look, that shirt is cute. It's $10. $10, I can't do that. Oh, I'm going to go food shopping. I made a box of cereal because I can't. Everything that I did was around my financial situation. And that thing oppressed me. I remember I was with my husband at Walmart, right? And I had like $25 in my bank account. Now the Lord supplies all my needs. That $25 came from the Lord. Amen. And the order came to $23. And I just went into a fit. After we got in the car, I'm crying. I'm just upset. Like, I'm just tired of struggling. Now, it was paid for. It was a done deal. And God has been faithful each and every time to provide what I needed. But I'm focused on the fact that I just made it. But I made it. So if there's somebody in here that just barely made it through the situation you just made it through, don't be like, oh, well, you know, I just barely made it out. No, you praise God. I barely made it out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But I made it. I'm standing here and I made it. Amen. And I'm sure that God gave you a vision of what he wants to do through you. I don't know about you, but God makes me dream like big, you know? So like right now I'm speaking to you guys and I'm glad to be here. But like I have dreams of like stadiums full of people. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know, I just see myself on the stage with a mic. I don't know if I'm singing, I don't know if I'm teaching, whatever. But I see seas of people. Yeah. Now that sounds good, like, yeah, that's great. But it's scary. It's scary, and you start to question yourself, God, can I really do that? Yeah. And God's like, no, but I can. Yeah. Hallelujah. We have to stop looking at our assignments through our own strength. God didn't send you there so that you could do it. He just needed a willing vessel. Yeah. Amen? And so while your gift makes room for you, your purpose hunts you down. Your purpose hunts you down when your gift is making room for you. So if your purpose is to encourage people through God's word, you're going to do that in the hair salon, you're going to do it at CVS, you're going to do it on the street corner, you might do it in the public restroom, might be a little weird, but it just comes out of you, right? It comes out of you. And so you can try to run from your purpose, but it's going to hunt you down. It's going to hunt you down. You're not going to be fulfilled, as someone was saying last night, you're not going to be fulfilled until you're operating in that thing. So that's why I had jobs at like Walmart, you know, as an asset protection. I don't know if you know what asset protection is, but we walk around in plain clothes and make sure people don't steal. Now, I'm not a security person. I'm not tackling nobody over a t-shirt. But what I was able to do was to run the safety meetings. I got to teach. I got to train. I got to empower people to be safe in Walmart. But I was teaching and training and empowering. That's my purpose. I would love safety meetings. I would get little games together and they were probably looking at me like, girl, this girl is crazy. But it was my purpose. That was my gifting. And so I did that even at Walmart. All right? So the next thing that our boxes can be made out of are excuses. Excuses. Woo-wee! Moses said to the Lord, pardon your servant, Lord, I've never been eloquent, neither in the past, nor since you've spoken to your servant. I'm slow of speech and of tongue. Moses pulled out his long list of why I can't. And we do that. Well, I can't go there because I don't have the money. I can't go there because I don't have the education. I can't go there because my shoes don't match. I can't go there because I got a hair out of place. I can't go there because my lashes fell off. What? We pull out a list, and some of our lists are longer than others, but we pull out a list of why we can't. And there's a difference between a reason and an excuse. No, well, this is my reason why I can't. No, that's an excuse why you can't. A reason is an explanation as to why something is the way that it is. That's a reason. An excuse is a type of reason used to explain improper behavior and pose it as acceptable. I couldn't get to church because I overslept. Is that a reason? No, I think that's an excuse. Amen. I couldn't, you know, come to your party because I couldn't come. And you know it's bad when you really just can't come up with anything that's logical. You know, so then we start dodging people, you know, and so there's a difference between excuses and reasons. And because God is sovereign, he won't require anything of you that he's not already given you the power and grace to do. Amen. So there's no reasoning with God. When God says go, you can't say, well, I can't go because I stubbed my big toe. If he told you to go, there's already been a green light granted in the spirit that it's time for you to go. He's not going to ask an orange to produce lemonade. Unless, because he's sovereign, he said, you know what, on this day at this time, I'm going to make that orange produce lemons because I'm a miracle working God. But in general, he's not going to send you to do something that you just cannot do. Amen? And so the box you may be in today might be made up of backwards thinking, oppressive outlooks, or excuses. She's doing a good job, right, y'all? She's doing good. So maybe you say, well, Minister Britt, that's not my testimony. I've dealt with my past, and I've got no issues, and I'm straight. Well, there are other things that your box can be made of, just in case. Your box can be made of blindness, lack of vision and clarity, obstacles, situation or circumstances, a lack of experience, right? Brokenness, you can't seem to stabilize emotionally, open wounds, lack of forgiveness, exposure to too much of the good thing or too much of a bad thing, right? Bullies, negative people around you who want to see you put down, overbearing relationships that let you dictate that you let dictate your every move. Exes, literally exes, can be a part of the box that you're in. People that you have soul ties with that you just can't let go. And if you still say, Minister Britt, I'm straight. I ain't none of that. I'm good. You ain't hit nothing on my list. Then you have a box made of pride.
Yeah.
Because we've all been there. We've all been somewhere. None of us were born perfect. None of us have had a perfect journey, and none of us in this room are perfect today. Right? And so we have to be 100% honest. And so there's always a step to be taken toward your destiny. There's always a step to be taken toward your destiny, whether it's a baby step or whether it's a giant step. You have to take a step, but you have to be honest with your box. You have to be honest with your box. If you want to move, you can move, but you have to be honest with your box. So three crucial things you need to adjust to destroy your box. Three things you need to adjust to destroy your box, okay? So the first thing is, you need to adjust your beliefs.
Good.
You need to adjust your beliefs about your situation, about yourself, and about God. Because sometimes we like to put God in a box. We like to put God in a box and say that he's just this lofty being far away that's just sitting over us and just being. No, God is he's a personal, right here, right next to you all the time, in your life kind of God. He's an in your situation, right there when you call, never leave you nor forsake you kind of God. He's always there. And so if you don't believe that your situation can be changed, you won't pray. You won't ask for prayer. You won't speak life, and you won't speak the word of God over it. If you don't believe there's a gift on the inside of you, you're not even going to try to stir. You're not even going to pick up the spoon. If you don't believe that there's a gift on the inside of you, if you don't believe that he can do what he said he could do, then you won't move, and you won't even expect it, right? And you get what you expect. If you expect nothing, you're going to get nothing. So you have to check your beliefs and adjust them. And all it's simple as choosing to believe something else. You know, as Minister Pam said, all you gotta do is say, I'm done with it, and that's it. Mm. And then, okay, so after you say you're done with it, you have to be intentional, because your beliefs affect your action. Y'all know that, right? And so your actions will show what you believe. If I didn't think that God was telling the truth when he said I was supposed to speak to people, I wouldn't be here. I'd be like, Minister Pam, I can't come. I can't make it because I stubbed my big toe. Right? If I didn't believe, I wouldn't be here. All right, so check your beliefs and adjust them. The next thing is, you have to adjust your obedience. You have to adjust your obedience. Either you've been doing what God has asked of you, or you aren't. And I'm so glad that God is gracious, because he forgives us over and over and over and over and over and over and over again, right? And so there's so much power in being obedient to God, because with God, the race is still long and hard, but he gives you the grace to run the race. The race is still long and hard, but now it's going to be longer than it has to be and harder than it has to be, when God has already given you a way to do it. And so you have to make sure that you don't become an Israelite that turns an 11-day journey into a 40-year sojourn. You know what I'm saying? They were supposed to go to 7-Eleven. They ended up going to California. Okay, so we want to make sure that our obedience is shifted. When God tells you to do something, just do it.
Yeah.
It's going to be scary. It's going to be, you know, it's not going to sound like it makes sense all the time. When God showed me this in the vision, I was like, that's going to be silly, Jesus. You know what I'm saying? But I understand that's how he works. The Bible says it clearly. He uses the foolish thing to confound the wise. Yeah. Yeah. And so you have to be obedient right away. Because delayed obedience is what? Disobedience. And so God wants a right now yes. He wants a right away yes. Amen. And then finally, you have to adjust. You have to adjust your execution. Adjust your execution. It's how you do things. There's no point in attempting to stir up the gifts if you aren't going to stir the way that God says. It's one thing to say yes, but it's another thing to do it how he says to do it. Right? And so you might want to use the KitchenAid to mix this one, but God says, no, baby, I want you to use the spoon because I have some muscles for you to develop in the midst of this thing. Amen? And so you have to be mindful. Once you figure out what the gift is and how to stir it up, you ought to have a confidence about you that shows up in your work. And you ought to operate with a certain level of excellence. There ought to be a certain level of expectation when you show up to do your thing. The Bible says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Your extraordinary God deserves exceptional service. So if you're ready to start living that life more abundantly, you got to destroy the box. If you're ready to start walking in purpose and destiny, you got to destroy your box. If you're ready to be fulfilled, you got to destroy the box. If you're ready to give God glory in all that you do, you have to destroy your box. So I need you guys to do me a favor and stand on your feet with me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And how many of you know that when God gives a demonstration, there is purpose in it?
Uh-huh.
And even though it might seem radical, it might seem silly, there's purpose in it. So as you're participating, God is doing some things in the spirit realm. And so if you're willing to get crazy for God, he's willing to get crazy for you.
Uh-huh.
And I want God to get crazy for me.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. So I want you to envision yourself inside your box. You know what your box is made of. You know what's keeping you bound. You know the people that you need to get rid of. You know the different decisions that you have to make. Envision yourself in that box. That box that's kept you hidden. That box that has kept you stagnant. And on the count of three, I want you to symbolically destroy the box that you're in. Whatever that looks like for you. Whatever that looks like for you. I want you to symbolically destroy that box. And I believe that as you fight this thing, as you tear it, and I don't mean just, don't just step out of it. No, I want you to rip it up. I want you to stomp on it. I want you to set it on fire. I want you to throw it in the trash. I want you to kill that box, okay? So on the count of three, I want you to destroy the box that you're in, and God is gonna be doing exactly that in the spirit realm. One, two, three. Destroy that box. Destroy it. Rip it. Step on it. Hallelujah. It might look silly. It might feel silly, but God is doing something in the spirit realm right now. Don't look at me. Destroy the box. Tear it up into little pieces. Throw it in the trash. Set it on fire. Hallelujah. God, we thank you. Hallelujah. We praise you. Hallelujah. And when you're done ripping it up, come on and give God praise. We magnify your name, oh Lord, and we thank you for what you did today, God. We thank you for what you're doing, Lord. We thank you that the boxes are destroyed once and for all. We thank you that we're no longer bound, oh God. We thank you, Father God, that through a visual, Lord, you showed us what we can do with the power. You showed us what we can do with the anointing that you've given us. You showed us what we can do in the presence of our brothers and sisters, Lord God. So, Father, I pray that you would empower your people today, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that they would receive what just took place in the spirit, Lord God. I believe, Lord God, that you've begun something. I believe, Lord God, that the waters are troubled, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Father. And I believe that there are people in this room that are willing to look crazy for you because they're desperate for a breakthrough. They're desperate for their destiny. They're desperate for that power of God to be in their lives. They're desperate to see their loved ones saved. And it'll only be done if they're outside of their box, God. So I declare a decree right now, freedom in this place. In the name of Jesus, I declare a decree, breakthrough in this place. In the name of Jesus, Father, we praise you, Lord. We praise you and we magnify you. And